let me invite all the speakers on the stage for a quick panel discussion. My first invite, Mr. Amit Kumar Srivatsava from Bosch, Mr. Nicholas Bokoff, Mr. Gokul Srinivas, Mr. Ganesh Shankar, and Mr. Tukiva. And I also would like to do this as a little bit different, like a jugalbandi of sorts. I will invite Mr. Yan also on the stage to kind of put all our panelists on a little bit of a more hotter seat. As it is going to be a little hot, but yeah, sure. Yan, over to you also. All right, so my first question is going to the very gentleman from Bosch, who's here. You know, all the battery technologies in the world is a kind of non-sustainable. So is this a myth or is this the truth? And what innovations are being adopted at Bosch in general and in India in particular? Over to you, Mr. Amit.
So if you see, there are multiple battery technologies that are right now coming in. The lithium ion basically is the most talked about, right? But if you dig deeper, you will see that there are companies in India which are talking about zinc manganese. There is another company which is talking about sodium ion, right? Then we are going towards fuel cells and all, right? See, each has their own plus and minuses, right? Right now, lithium ion we see basically a lot of dependency on certain countries who are owning mines. Now, let me tell you what Bosch is doing in battery management. So one we are trying. What we are doing is basically battery management systems for commercial vehicle, passenger cars, three wheelers, two wheelers, because if it is battery, it's basically a full, you have got a kind of a bomb, actually electric bomb, which is running on, specifically for the bus kind of thing scenario, where you have to really see how is the, you have to continuously monitor what is the health of the battery at every point of time. You have to see which battery is performing high, low, and you have to, on a real-time basis, you have to manage the power. And then you're also developing multiple applications like remote kill, remote management, all that from a battery perspective. So specifically on the battery segment, we are not manufacturing battery, but we are doing most of the other things around battery right now.
Amit just got sparked by Suez. You know, you are building the Suez Canal. Well, what a task. What a task. And I'm just wondering, we had this quote today that doing things together is one thing which divides us from animals. It's communication. And building a Suez Canal needs a lot of communication. Having a water sewage plant in Santiago de Chile with how many? 7 million people sewage, processed?
7 million.
That's quite a lot. So you have to have a lot of workers working there. Sir?
Workers, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many?
The operators, actually.
So?
Several hundred. Yeah.
Several hundred. So what would be a smartphone provided from him?
Yes.
Solve the solution of getting the communication inside the plant done? If you want to, you can sign a contract here, but
you don't need to say immediately.
No, after the session.
Yeah, after this session, yeah.
So is there specific advices you have to tell your workers that would be, helpful to have a smartphone like that, providing the information and to get your system running better?
Okay, so it's a vast question behind. So let me try to maybe answer with two aspects. So the first one, the first challenge that we face in our business is that the value in that we accumulate over the years is experience. And to be able to transmit and communicate experience, but it's a matter of formalizing and also training, communicating, etc., between the people in the different sites, but also in the different geographies and at different period of time. So it may happen that tomorrow in some country we are going to face a situation that our ancestors already faced 50 years back in another country. So how do we do to capitalize this know-how and to be able to take advantage or to benefit from it? So that's the first challenge that we face in this kind of organization. It's linked to communication, knowledge management, actually. Now, in the day-to-day operations, it's exactly the purpose of smart city or digital operations in smart cities is to be able to know everything and to communicate everything in real time. So all the people, all the stakeholders who are supposed to get information, to get informed, should be informed in real time. If I take the example, a customer is calling, complaining about anything happening in the city, there is some garbage, there is a water leak, then immediately it goes to some on-duty team, to some field workers who are doing the investigation, and then maybe the next day or the afternoon, the repair. So all those information should be shared in real time so that the customer, the first one who has called, knows in real time what's happening, maybe with his smartphone or with his tablet or website. So that's today, yes, the core challenge or the core offer and value addition of a digital utility. And we need tools, we need support and creative solutions for that.
I'm sorry that I was asking you so directly, but you know, we're talking about smart cities and smart city solutions. At the same time, we as provider for smart city solutions should think smart. And that's the objective of getting us all on the table here, having Minion you know, detecting all these things, having Genflow detecting all these things, but how do we connect together? So this was the trigger I've got. But I'm handing over to Mohan again.
Right. So my next question is to Gokul Srinivas from Minion Labs. Almost a decade ago, when somebody told me that your cars are now going to have IoT sensors and the data is going to be sent to the insurance provider, because I have a tendency to sometimes use the car to fly. So I am now scared with all the data that's going to go from my household lights, which switches that I'm going to turn on to an insurance provider. So how is this going to be, is that again going to be a boon or a bane? Because everybody is going to have my data, which lights I'm turning on, which geysers I'm using. So I'm worried. So why don't you help me too?
So starting with this, it's again a generational gap, I think.
Hello. Yeah. That obviously made me too old.
Yeah, it's a generational gap, I think, because this Minion, I started this as part of my academic project. So I started with this sensors, but if you look at the decades back, and the decades back, the students who did their academic project, they weren't aware of these IoT solutions that time. But right now, I'm like a past student in 2015, and like we got to know these sensors, and we started doing this. So, and then the data part, it's again a big subject. How do we use the data, either for a good or bad? It's up to the user's perspective, and as part of, from the government, as part of this society, there are policies like GDPR and few other things, which makes a framework where we should not do these things and where we can do these things. Personally, I before getting into this entrepreneurship, I was working as a security expert at Amazon. So I know what data we can do, how do we manipulate for what, but what are all the things we shouldn't do?
Actually, that leads me to a question to the audience. Who in this room would be prepared to give your private data away to do a real impact for climate change? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, some more coming up? Well, it's probably about the trust. You know, how do I trust people talking about these big values like climate change and we do something about it, and then giving my data away for that? So I would like to ask again, Bosch. What do you provide for us as customers, consumers, that we can really trust you, that you are into circular economy, that you use the data in the battery, in your switches, for the good?
Okay. So there are two levels of data. One is the application level data, and second is the personal data. Now, many of you are operating Microsoft, right? And Microsoft or iOS, pop-up comes and says, I'm going to use this information to basically improve my product, okay? And then most likely, and I'm not storing any personal information, and most likely, a lot of us actually kind of tick box that, thinking, yeah, I mean, next time my Windows operating system will not crash more, right? So it's basically going back to the greater good that we're talking about. Now, when we are building the solutions, we are only taking data which is used for the behavior. So for example, battery, I am taking data related to battery performance so that it doesn't explode. I can improve my battery management system. I'm not really trying to do who is actually, Amit is driving it or X is driving it. While we do get use cases from our customers saying that, can I remote kill the battery? So the guy is driving and can I remotely do it? Yes, technologically it is possible, but then would you want to do it? So we do get that kind of thing. So mostly we take data from the device to the cloud only which is on new to know basis. Most of the data we now keep it at the edge level. So edge computing, phantom data I talked about, that's most of them edge computing. So yeah.
Thanks, Amit.
Thank you. So I think you might have all read in the newspapers that Bangalore has turned out to become the most worst city or nightmares in terms of traffic. I wouldn't be surprised if it is even called the most chaotic city as well, because you can't really predict anything. And at the days that we are in today, I wish to have a home which is completely self-sustainable. I grow my own vegetables. I have everything at the fingertips. So I would like to really hear Shankar Ganesh from Fluxgen as to what is it that they are doing, how is it that it can impact small communities or even single families in terms of being self-sustainable.
So that was a kind of a image that I showed is something that in my entire life I want to achieve. Right. So it is probably not possible in very soon. So right now we are doing our solution mainly for, as I said, like companies like Titan and industries, many of those factors, and 25 customers we are supplying. The thing is, it is said, I mean, it based on the report, more than 50% of water meant for human use goes to industries. So if industries can consume less water, that water is available to residents like us. And industries not just only consume more water, they also pollute the water, right? So if this water is less consumed and it is less properly managed, then there's a good chance that the water that I get in my home from aquifers is not contaminated. So that is what we are immediately working on. I believe all industries should go water positive. Facilities should go water positive. How do you go water positive? So first approach is to make sure that you're using least amount of water to produce the same amount of goods. That is reducing water consumption. That's where we are right now. The second thing that you have to do is, can you reuse this water, recycle and use most of this water? Probably it is not possible to do 100%, but most of it can be done. And the next aspect is, can you harvest water from rainfall? That could be the difference of this wasted water. So we want, in next 10 years, we want to be in this field itself, because this is a challenging field and it's not going to be solved in immediately. So you want to be part of all this component. Monitor data in terms of water, analyze this data, and improve the water infrastructure. So I should also again thank my previous job in GE, where I learned Six Sigma, where define, measure, analyze, and control. So the aim is to make sure that these facilities, including commercial facilities, become water positive, so that you and I can be sure that we are not using the water used by industries, and we can the water that we get from Kaveri or some of these rivers is coming mostly to the reservoirs. That's what we are working on.
Well, question to the guy next to me, left. we just had this use case with sewers, and I was today in the morning. We had a lot of solutions around about people and people's behavior. How do you convince anyone to use your phone because the employer tells me I have to? Why?
Why? If employee doesn't have like a smartphone, manager can provide a smartphone, our phone to employee for improvement of their work. But if they have individual smartphone, they can use our phone for just only work. So because it means that they don't have to make their phone that dirty, job application. So they don't have to install a job application to their individual device. So they don't want to show their family picture or location data to the manager. They need to use our phone. But it depends on the cost budget of a company. If company can pay the cost of our phone, they can provide our phone to their employee. But they don't have a budget, so they have to use an individual device. It's called BYOD, bring your own device.
Right. So you're saying your smartphone is like a shovel.
Shovel?
Like a shovel?
A shovel, yeah. Right.
You can only use for shoveling and nothing else.
Yeah, right.
Well, there's one experience. If there's no fun with it, you don't use it.
Sorry?
If there's no fun with it, you don't use it.
Yeah.
We all should think about this question of delight and non-delight, but I see your point.
Well, depends on the how to use it depends on the demand on the people's application. So if people want to use a gaming application or YouTube for their entertainment, they have to buy another Android device. But if after we can get application from application developer WhatsApp or another application, so we can sell this device to the consumers directly. So we don't have an application ecosystem now. But after that, we can sell this device to the consumer directly. And parent or manager don't have to worry about waste time and
Okay, thanks. Okay. All right, so let Josu handle the rest of the session. Thank you, everybody, for being on the panel.